So I'm just going to repeat that. So we're talking about doing your end of year taxes, which is a weird concept because you're doing this in by April 15th of 2018, but you're actually looking back at 2017. And so the U.S. government taxed you all during 2017. You received paychecks. They took money out for all these things we just did on the paycheck situation. But in 2018, you look back at 2017, and you may have qualified for tax deductions based off what happened in 2017. For example, one of the major tax deductions currently is interest that you pay on a mortgage is tax deductible. And you say, I thought we were already doing tax exempt things, but that's per paycheck. Now you have to move your mindset from, we're not looking at how much income you earned for a single paycheck. We're talking about how much income did you earn all of 2017? What was your total income for the year in 2017? You say, how much total did the federal government take from you in federal income tax in 2017? Well, I'll show you forms, and your employer will basically tell you, this is how much the U.S. government took from you in federal income tax for all of last year. And so when you file your taxes, you're talking about things that you wouldn't be able to calculate until 2017 was over. Okay, if I look at my documents and information that was supplied to me in 2017, I ended up paying this much in interest on my mortgage. Let's talk college expenses. In 2017, I had two children at university, and these were the expenses I incurred in 2017 because of tuition and books and so forth. Or, you know what, I'm paying off college loans, and I was paying college loans in 2017, and this is how much interest I paid on my college loans. I donated money to charity. Hey, you know what? I donated money every month in 2017 to charity, and this is the total amount of money that I donated in 2017. Let's see, what would be another tax deduction that would be for 2017? Child care comes into play. You know what? I had to pay for child care so that I could go to work because I have young children. They're not in school yet. And this is how much total I paid in childcare in 2017. And so you calculate in 2018, you calculate all the stuff that happened in 2017. And when it's all said and done, you say, okay, based off my deductions that I qualify for in 2017, this is how much I should have paid in federal income tax. Notice I didn't say Social Security, I didn't say Medicare, I didn't say state tax, didn't say personal choice, just federal income tax. This is how much I should have paid in federal income tax, and look, this is less than what they took from me in 2017. Or another way to say that, the U.S. government took more from me than they should have in 2017. So I want that money back. And you fill out your paperwork and you turn in your taxes and you get a tax refund. You're like, I'm getting a refund? The IRS is sending me a check or depositing it into my account directly, which they do now. They used to send you a paper check. You're like, cool, I just got paid by the government. Did you get paid by the government? What did you get? You got your own money back. You got your own money back. So you'd say, well, this seems like a weird process because why not just wait until 2017 is done and then have everybody calculate this stuff and then decide how much you have to pay in federal income tax? Why don't they do that? First, I want to answer that question. I mean, it seems weird to be like, let's look back at what ended up happening in 2017 and like retroactively figure out if they took too much or not enough or just took the right amount. Why don't they just wait till 2017 is done and then calculate all this tax stuff?
Well, maybe because the end of 2017, like maybe there's not enough time.
But you're missing the big picture. Why isn't the U.S. government wait until 2017 is done and then take all this information into account and say, okay, this is what you owe us in federal income tax.
They can't look at everything. It's your own personal life. It'd be too hard for each individual person to look and study everyone that's doing their taxes.
That's part of it. It'd be a paperwork nightmare, but you're still missing the big picture. They need the money. What are they going to do, wait around during 2017 and go, we're not currently collecting any federal income tax from anybody because we're waiting for 2017 to be done so we can see what the information is. They need the money, they being the government. So they tax you all during 2017 with limited information. What's the information they have? They know your income, or that it's coming in every paycheck. They know your family size. And they might know about some things that have already been earmarked as tax deductible. They don't know how much interest you're going to pay in your mortgage. The government doesn't know how much you're going to end up paying in child care costs, if any. The government doesn't know what your expenses are for children in university. The government doesn't know all these things that you can qualify for as a tax deduction for your end of year taxes. So then once the year is done, you fill out all this paperwork and say, let me tell you, U.S. government, about the things that happened in 2017. And based off my calculations, you took too much federal income tax from me in 2017, so I will be receiving a refund. It's possible they didn't take enough from you in 2017. Johannes goes to the casino, puts in a coin, holds the lever, he wins $1 million. Is that $1 million going to be taxable? You guess so is right. In fact, that casino has to report that to the IRS and to say, we had a big winner, this is their name, this is their social security number, this is how much they won, reported to the IRS. Has the IRS, so now your income for 2017, let's say it's normally $50,000. Well, your income now for 2017 is $1,050,000. Is the U.S. government in 2017 taxing you like your income is going to be $1,050,000? Well, they tax you like your income is probably whatever your employer keeps reporting, because your employer is reporting your income every paycheck. So they're taxing you like your income is going to be $50,000. Like, I just said that's the norm or something. So then when you go to do your taxes in 2018 and it says, what was your income for 2017? You're like, my income was $1,050,000. And then you calculate your taxes. They didn't take enough federal income tax from you because they didn't know about all this income. So what are you going to have to do? You're going to have to pay more. You'll be like, you know what? I owe the IRS. I did my taxes. I filed my taxes. I owe the IRS more than what they took from me in 2017. I have to literally send the IRS a check. It's also possible that you file your taxes, you get done with the process, and you calculate the federal income tax that should have been taken out in 2017, and it works out to be exactly what they took out. You're like, yeah, the way my calculations match up with what they took for me, I don't get a tax refund. I don't owe the IRS more money. It just, we're even. But I still have to do my taxes. I still have to file them, send them to the IRS and say, I don't think I should be receiving a tax refund, and I don't think I should be paying you even more than what you took from me in 2017. Mm-hmm. They do. Well, I mean, they will. It'll be taxed. It might not just be taxed right at that moment in time. That's the whole point of doing the end of the year taxes, to say you're gonna get taxed at some point. I don't exactly know how it works. Like, I don't think the casino, maybe they take out a chunk of the million right then and there because they know federal income tax is going to be applied to it. Unfortunately, I've never won $1 million at the casino, so I don't exactly know how it works. But I'm trying to think of situations where your income actually ends up being higher than what the government was kind of assuming or planning your income was. Mm-hmm. It's called tax evasion. And so there's two situations. If you avoid paying your taxes, then basically you can go to jail, right? You go to jail, tax evasion. Or there's people who try to cheat on their taxes. And so they'll say that they donated money to charity that they never donated. Or they'll try to claim deductions and stuff that aren't actually real. And you might get away with it. Or you might get what's called audited. And so you see in the movies that somebody's knocking on the door and, hello, I'm from the IRS or something. Or they're all worried because they're being visited by a representative of the Internal Revenue Service. And the representative from the IRS says, well, hello there, we have some questions about your tax return. It says here, Yusuf, that you donated $50,000 to Jafer Charity last year. We can't find any record of this charity, and we don't see any record of you actually making any transactions for $50,000. Do you have any documentation that you could show us that verifies that you really did donate $50,000 to this charity? Could you tell us more about this charity and what it is that the money's going towards? And again, making up a goofy situation to say people will always try to lie, cheat any system. And so part of the job of the IRS is to try to get people who are refusing to pay taxes or don't pay taxes, or get people that are lying or putting false information about their taxes. But there's so many taxpayers, and the IRS is only so big, so I think statistically, the probability of you getting audited is about less than 1%, I think. I think about 1% of all taxpayers end up getting audited. So when he's talking about how to prepare your tax return, he's really talking about keeping track of documentation that you will need when you go to file your taxes, because you need documentation proof of things that have occurred. So let me see what he says here.
2, how to prepare your tax return. 3, how to prepare your tax return. And 4, in summation. So to fully explain how we're going to pay taxes, let's do as Wonderlanders do and begin in the beginning. Part 1, how to prepare your tax return. Now, to really understand how employee taxes work, we have to jump in the TARDIS and go back in time, because you may not realize you've been paying taxes all year long. Before you start employment, your employer will require you to fill out a federal and state W-4. The W-4 will ask you things like your marital status and how many exemptions you would like to claim.
So when you first get a job in the U.S., one of the first things they have you fill out is this W-4 form. And so this is how the government gets an idea of what your family size is and so forth. Right? So we're doing paycheck to paycheck, and we're like, you get this many withholding allowances. You're like, how does the government have any idea what my family size is? Well, you're filling out this form when you first get a job, and it gives basic information. And so they're using this information for the paycheck to paycheck situation when they're like, okay, we're going to tax you on less than your full income.
4, the W-4 will ask you things like your marital status and how many exemptions you would like to claim. What's an exemption? Definition time, exemptions are things that lessen your tax burden and pertain primarily to personal and dependency statuses. The IRS has a great W-4 worksheet on their website, but for our purposes, I can safely tell you that the fewer exemptions you claim, the more money will be taken out of your paycheck. So anyway, the W-4 will be used by your employer to determine how much state and federal income tax to withhold from your paycheck throughout the year. Basically, they're trying to predict how much you owe and to have you pay it throughout the year rather than at one time. Now, you may find out...
That's a key statement there. They're trying to predict how much you're going to owe, and they're taking it from you over the course of a year rather than taking it all at one time at the end of the year. So again, as you are calculating your paycheck stuff, you're in essence doing what the government is estimating should be coming out of your paycheck each month, if we say, for federal income tax. But you might get to the end of the year and go, no, you took out too much because of these reasons.
Eventually, that you will pay too much throughout the year, in which case you will receive a tax refund. And definition time, a tax refund is a reimbursement on taxes when the tax burden is actually less than the taxes paid. In other words, dude, you gave me too much. Here it is. Save it. What I'm trying to say is that the W-4 is a super-duper important form, and it can prevent, if properly completed, a very nasty surprise at the end of the year. You can see April 15th approaching. But anyway, part two, how to prepare your taxes. Okay, so when you're with that, you can see April 15th approaching with your prophecy powers, Professor Trelawney. So to prepare your tax return, you're going to need a few things. One, your W-2. Your employer is required by law to send you what is called a W-2, postmarked by January 31st. The W-2 is sent to you and also to the IRS, and it gives you all the important information to complete your tax return.
Okay, I'll show you another example of a W-2 form, but people don't keep track of this stuff. If we get to the end of 2017 and you're like, hey, how much did the federal government take from you in 2017? You're like, I have no idea. Your employer in January of 2018 gives you this form. And they say this form tells you about everything that happened in 2017. This is how much Social Security tax you paid in 2017. This is how much Medicare tax you paid in 2017. This is how much federal income tax you paid in 2017. And you're going to need this information when you file your taxes. If you're like, hey, you took too much for me in federal income tax in 2017, you're like, how do you even know how much they took? Did you keep all your paychecks? Were you writing it down every time you got a paycheck? People don't do that. So they get a form at the beginning of 2018 from their employer that says, here's a summary about the previous year.
The W-2 is sent to you and also to the IRS, and it gives you all the important information to complete your tax return. Definition time. A tax return is a form on which a taxpayer makes a statement annually on personal circumstances and income, and it is used by tax authorities to assess the tax liability of said taxpayer. Basically, you owe us this much money. Possibly required equipment. Number two, other information forms. In addition to your W-2, you may have other income information forms. These may include a 1099 IMT, which is for interest income, a form 1099 DIV, which is for stock.
So now I started talking about how you have other forms that, you know, like even money that you make from stocks, that has to be reported as income. Even dividends that you're paid, that has to be reported as income. That would be another reason why you possibly might end up paying more to the IRS when you do your taxes. You say, look, I got a bunch of income here that you haven't really taxed me on yet. I have income from shares of stock that I sold. I have income from dividends that were paid to me because I own these shares of stock. That has to be reported as income. I mean, it will be reported by Vanguard. Vanguard will send information to the IRS that says, Greg Brink received X amount in dividend income. He received X amount in selling of shares, whatever, bonds. So then that's all part of filing your taxes.
Wait, so if you don't sell your shares and stocks, you don't actually have...
I won't pay taxes on my gain of the shares of stock until I actually sell them and get those gains. But I do have to pay a little bit on the dividends because my index fund, when other people are in the index fund, actually, when dividends are received for the fund, those dividends are paid out to all the people that own shares within that fund. I have the choice of just buying more shares. Like I say, reinvest any dividends that are due to me. Just buy me more shares of the fund. But I still have to report my part of the dividends as income when I go to do my taxes.
now, at long last, we are on part three of this video, how to prepare your tax return. With e-filing as the predominant form of filing, you will most likely use some kind of online avenue or downloaded software to prepare and pay your tax. TurboTax is the most popular, and IRS.gov supplies free software for anyone with income up to $58,000 a year.
So, for too many years, I found out now, I paid somebody to do my taxes for me each summer. And the reason I paid somebody to do my taxes is I was worried about, I live overseas, I'm making income in Oman, I own three different houses, two of them are rentals, so I have rental income, I'm paying somebody to manage those houses, I have some other, I have investment situations. Like, I was worried that my financial life was too complex and that I would miss out on certain things, or I wouldn't know about certain deductions that I could be taking. And so I paid somebody to do my taxes year after year after year. Well, 2 years ago, I finally said, why don't I just try it myself using like TurboTax? And so I told the person who's been doing my taxes that I might still hire you to do my taxes again, but I'm going to try it myself using software, and if it doesn't seem like it's working or I don't feel confident about it, I'm going to hire you to do my taxes again. And so I bought the software, and I started filling out the information and doing my taxes, and I wish I would have been doing that way before. It wasn't that difficult. The software does a good job of asking you questions, of saying, what's your situation? Do you own any rental property? Yes, I do. How many properties? Okay. Well, how long have you owned the house? How much did you pay for the house originally? How much are you receiving in rental income? How much do you pay the person that manages the house? Da 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 da. So it walks me through and asks all these questions. And I'm just answering the questions or putting in information. And then the software calculates and says, you would qualify for these deductions based off these questions. In fact, it even imports my information from Vanguard. If I let it says, can we just pull the information from Vanguard for you? I'm like, yep, this is my username. This is my password, which I was a little like, I don't know if I want to do this. I'm like, all right, this is my username. This is my password. So then online, they went into Vanguard. Vanguard had the info, got imported into TurboTax. They're like, all right, we've got all the information about your shares of stock, dividends, that type of stuff. It's all there. I'm like, cool. And did the rest of it. And now I've done it the last 2 years myself using software. And I really wish I would have been doing it myself using software many years previous. It wasn't as complex as I thought it was going to be for my financial situation.
Whether you prepare your return manually or with software, IRS.gov is actually a really wonderful resource. One of the great things about using software is that it will prepare your state and federal taxes at the same time, which saves a lot of legwork, let me tell you. Okay, so finally, this is what you've been waiting for. Here is how to prepare your tax return. Step one, choose the correct form. All the available forms will be 1040 of some kind. The 1040 EZ.
Okay, so then you start talking about particular forms. And even though Logan's packing up shop, we still got a good 15 minutes of class left. I don't know, you're putting stuff away. I was getting confused by that. I don't know. Don't we? Is it not 9:38 or
a minute?
A minute? Am I way off? We go to 9:55. Okay. So again, Captain, pack it up. Just we still got about 15, well, at least 15 minutes left here. Okay. So what I've done is, this is an example. Again, it's just something I pulled off the internet, but this is an example of a W-2 form that you would like receive from your employer in January of the year after your, like, you would receive this in January of 2018 for filling out your 2017 taxes. You say, tell me what happened in the previous year. So in this example, the employer is supposedly the kitchen corner. This is the employee. Okay? And it says, this is how much we paid you last year. This was your wages, tips, or other compensation. This is how much that we paid you. And then it says, this is how much was used to calculate your Social Security. This was your taxable income for Medicare. This was, I don't know what Social Security tips is. I don't know what that is. But then over here it says, in the previous year, this is how much was taken from you for Social Security tax. This is how much was taken from you for Medicare tax. And this is how much was taken from you for federal income tax. And so this is the value that you might end up getting some of that money back, or you might have to pay more than that, or you might say, yep, I've calculated my taxes and that was the correct amount, so no refund, but I don't have to pay any more either. And so then you have actual forms that you're filling out. And so this form is if your life is pretty simple financially. It's called the 1040 EZ. And so if you have a pretty simple financial life, you're like, look, I don't really, I mean, you can even do this if you have kids. If you say, I don't really have any deductions. I don't have things like subtract this, subtract this, subtract this, subtract this. Then you fill out this form. It's really just the front side of one page and you'll be done filing your taxes. And you're like, oh, I thought this tax stuff was so difficult. And you're like, no, it's just the front of one page. But this is if your financial life is pretty simple. If your financial life is pretty simple, then filing your taxes, you definitely shouldn't be hiring somebody to do it. You just fill out the piece of paper or go online now. You go online and you type in your info. And even if you want to use this form, you can go right to the IRS government site and it pops up and you fill in your info and okay, it's done. Upload it, done. Now, if your financial life is more complex, then there's going to be other forms that you have to use. So this form is the one that I use. And it's not the information on there I want you to have a sense of. I just want you to have a sense of like what the categories are. Tell us about your filing status. Are you single? Are you married? Married filing jointly? Married filing separately? So you can have two people that are married that are both working, but you only file one tax return for the both of you. Exemptions. Tell us about your kids and give us their Social Security numbers and how big's your family, basically. Tell us about all your income that you earned in the previous year, and look at all those different things there. Qualified dividends, capital gain, which is profit from selling shares of stock, rental real estate, unemployment compensation. That's an interesting one. So you receive unemployment benefits from the government. If they're in excess of $2,400, you have to report that as income, and it starts to get factored into your tax situation. Adjusted gross income. So these would be types of things that you can start to subtract. Educator expenses, moving expenses, student loan interest deduction, these types of things. So you have to start to report numbers for those. And on the back, there's more. Tax and credits. And so you've got all these things, and when I do the taxes, again, the software is filling out, putting the numbers where they need to be. It's asking me questions. I enter it. It's not that difficult. It looks worse than it is. Payments, and then it says, okay, are you going to end up getting a refund? Like when you did these calculations, did you calculate it that your federal income tax was less than what we took from you? Okay, then where should we send the refund? So here they're like, give us your information, your bank account information, and we will put the refund directly into your bank account for you. Or did you calculate that you owe us more, amount you owe? And you're like, okay, I've calculated and I owe this much more. And then you have to sign your tax return. And if somebody prepared it for you, they have to sign here. Preparer's signature. And so forth. So then there's all kinds of other forms that pertain to particular situations, but this is what it means to file your end of year taxes and why some people get stressed about it, or they say, oh, I'm running out of time, or I need to hire somebody to do my taxes for me. It's an interesting, I know, you know, other countries do it differently or so forth, or you say, why not just tax people and then just be like, it is what it is. We taxed you during 2017 and 2017 is done, so on to 2018. I'm not saying it's right or it's wrong or it's good or it's bad. I'm just like, why is the U.S. government doing a system like this? It seems kind of backwards, or it seems like a lot of paperwork.
Well, one, maybe because without doing this type of process, it'd be easier to get away from things like your casino, for example.
That's true. So maybe this process helps keep people more accountable, perhaps. Yeah, that would be one thing. But you could, on your casino, you could just say you've been mandated by the government, tell the casinos that if you have a big winner, you take X chunk right then. And you have to send it to the IRS. But I agree with you. This might help in terms of accountability, but I don't think it's the big picture. Why do this type of process? I think they're trying to cater to the individual almost a little too much, to say, like, we know that everybody's situation is different, so we're trying to cater to your situation, and we're trying to help you out with your situation, or trying to help you out with your situation and yours and yours and yours, and everybody's situation's a little bit different, so we're going to do this process that really tries to individualize your tax situation. I don't know, maybe that's a good thing, maybe it's not. Maybe you just say, look, I don't really care what your individual situation is. This is the tax rate, and this is what you're going to pay. I mean, you could also have what's called a flat tax, but flat taxes don't necessarily work either. A flat tax is just, we're going to take X percent of your income, period. You make $1 million a year, well, we're taking 10% of your income. You make $20,000 a year, we're taking 10% of your income. You make $200,000 a year, we're taking 10% of your income. Done. Why doesn't that, I mean, it works, but what's the problem with a flat tax? I mean, everybody's paying the same percentage, so isn't that fair? He paid 10% of his income, he paid 10% of his income, you paid 10% of your income. But it's the same percentage.
Yeah, but if I make $30,000, I'm like, oh, I can't buy milk this week because I gotta take kids to school or something, use gas. Like, you're really penny pinching.
Yeah.
And you have $200,000. 10% isn't anything.
So it's all relative to say, and I'm just repeating that same concept to say, what is the effect of taking 10% from someone making $1 million? You took $100,000 from them. That's a lot of money. They still have $900,000 left. You take 10% from somebody that makes $20,000 a year, that's only $2,000. You're like, see, we took $2,000 from you, we took $100,000 from that guy. But the effect of taking that $2,000 from the person that has $20,000 of income, that's going to make some serious issues for you. Taking 10% of your money, and you're like, you took $2,000 from me. You're like, $2,000. We took $100,000 from that guy. That $100,000 has really no effect on his lifestyle. He's got $900,000. Taking $2,000 from him, that's going to have some definite effects. He's only got $20,000 to work with in the first place. Now you just took $2,000 of that away. That's the issue of a flat tax. Is to say, it is the same percentage for everybody. We're treating everybody the same as a percentage, but what's the effect on the wealthy compared to the poor, that type of thing. So you try to maybe individualize and treat people differently a little bit based off their income. But another problem with the current tax structure, and that's one of Trump's things that he's done this year, is he has tried to simplify. He did this tax cut, and they removed a bunch of deductions, I guess, to supposedly simplify the tax code. Its first year it will go into effect will be when we do taxes in 2019 for 2018. So I'm curious to see if there will be any big difference in the complexity of it or how it will affect taxpayers. But they did pass recently some tax cut slash change to the tax code. I don't know all the specifics of it and how it'll be different. Good question. He said if they're removing deductions, doesn't that really mean people will be paying more in taxes? So how can they say it's a tax cut? Correct. He wants them to pay less or whatever. So next class, I'll talk to you what's called the standard deduction. The U.S. government doesn't want to try to figure out if everybody's telling the truth or go through all the paperwork of everybody that has these deductions. So they offer what's called the standard deduction, which just says, if your individual itemized deductions are not more than this amount, then don't bother doing individual deductions. Here's another way to say it. Let's say that you make $50,000 a year. And you're like, and I say to you, we have already assumed that you're going to take the standard deduction. So we've taxed you, not like your income's $50,000. We've taxed you all during 2017 like your income is $30,000. We've already, in essence, given you a standard deduction. We've already subtracted $20,000 worth of itemized things. And you're like, wow, that's cool because I don't actually have that much in itemized things. And you're like, doesn't matter. We've already given you that cushion. We've already taxed you like you make $30,000, even though we know you make $50,000. See, the only way you're going to itemize is if your itemized deductions would actually lower it even more than what the government has already assumed or given you what they'll lower it by. Does that make sense or not? So it's like, so what they did when they changed the tax code is they even increased the standard deduction even more. So if I, in my situation, said you make $50,000, but all during 2017, we only taxed you like you made $30,000. Maybe in the next tax code, it's like you made $50,000, but we only taxed you like you made $25,000. Now, if your individualized deductions would lower your taxable income even more than what the government has already lowered it by, then go ahead. Go ahead and show us and give us the individual things that you want us to subtract and show us that your taxable income is even lower than what we've already calculated in during 2017. Mm-hmm.
And they have like these types of forms separate for like people that own businesses.
Correct. Correct. There's tons of forms, which is another nice thing about the software. Again, the software process has really only been in the last maybe like 10 years. I mean, the government's been collecting taxes, of course, for hundreds of years. But this software thing has really only come into play in the last 10 years or so. So I have very vivid memories of when I first had a job and so forth. I went to the post office and they had a booklet for the taxes, and it had forms in the booklet and stuff. And then they had these shelves with other forms that, like, do you need this form? Do you need this form? Do you need this form? You're like, I need that form. Oh, yeah, I need this one. So that's another big change with the software because, of course, all the forms are built into the software. And based off how you answer the questions, it will say, okay, and it puts the information for you and puts the forms in your return for you. So that makes it a lot easier, a lot easier for you. Okay? Wow, I'm sure that they'll be watching all 40 minutes of this video. I mean, they will be popping popcorn. They'll be just tied in, sitting on the edge of their seat. No, sitting on their edge of the seat. I mean, they'll be loving it. Yeah, Johannes is going to watch it again. I mean, I better get this thing uploaded quick. He's going to want to watch it at lunch. I mean,